I welcome you all for the today's class, that is PSP. Today we'll start with the module 1 there. Okay, the first thing what we can start here is about the discrete Fourier transform. So in the previous class we have just gone through with the basic information about why we are studying about the DSP. And two different forms we have seen, analog and digital. And finally, we came to a concept called as DFT, discrete Fourier transform. In short, we call it as DFT. So this DFT is a tool that computes Fourier transform on digital computation there. So what happens here is that we convert the time domain to a frequency domain. As we can just see it in a block diagram, a time domain is represented by a small value, that is small case x of n. When it is transformed with the help of a DFT tool, we are going to get a capital X of k, which is a representation in the frequency domain. So frequency analysis is very simpler and easy to understand. So that's why we always convert that to a frequency domain while analyzing there. So analysis of this discrete signal in Fourier transform is called as discrete Fourier transform. In order to understand the depth of DFT, it has evolved. You have to just understand that. Amit, unmute yourself. Amit. Okay. All of you keep your speaker mute there. Okay, it will be disturbing. Now, to understand that it has evolved, we have to know one of the important concepts called as discrete time Fourier transform. It is called as DTFT. So the general definition of this DTFT, we can just check it out here. It is called as capital X of E of j omega, which is equal to a summation of n is equal to 0 to infinity x of n e raised to minus j omega n. We have taken only the causal system for the positive domain. So where we can see that we are converting from a time domain to the frequency domain. In the right hand side, you can just check it out. We have x of n. And in the right hand side, we can just check it out. We have an omega value there. So this is a general definition of a DTFT, that is a discrete time Fourier transform. Now, with the help of this particular expression, we are going to get what is the actual expression for discrete time Fourier transform, that is DFT, what we are going to get now, discrete Fourier transform. So if you observe that DTFT, the omega is represented in the similar fashion as in the Z transform, as we have a region of convergence. So this is the radius of r to 1. And omega angular frequency, what we are going to say that. And as it is angular frequency, it is covering from 0 to 2 pi. When it is 0 to 2 pi, it is periodic in nature. It means that if any infinite sequences are there, we have transformation function there. In the same way, analog representation, omega capital, that is W, is a discrete representation of the omega there. If you are using it as a continuous signal, omega symbol, what you can just check it out, ohm symbol, varying from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now, if you take a Fourier transform of this particular function, as we already written there, we get a frequency domain. Take an inverse transform, we are going to get again back the time domain function. Now we already seen the definition of the DTFT. We have an inverse discrete time Fourier transform definition there. Now, as we are saying is that we are going to get a from discrete to continuous when we perform IDFT. IDFT means what? From the frequency transformation, we are going to get the time domain function. When we are going to get a time domain function, it is a continuous function what we have there. Pi 0 to x of e raised to j omega into e raised to j omega n dw. This is the general definition pair of a DTFT and the IDTFT. Generally, this is not used in the discrete Fourier transform. Why we are not going to use and what are the drawbacks of this DTFT? We'll just check it out there. So these transforms are defined for infinite length signal. So in order to practically perform with the help of a computer on an infinite signal, it becomes a complexity. So we are not going to use this DTFT. We are converting that to a DFT and then performing. That's the advantage of the DFT there. This has solved the problem of this DTFT. They have functions of continuous variables, as we can just check it out, W or Z. Due to this, they cannot be processed by computer or a DSP processor. That's the main drawback why we cannot access for the continuous signal there. To solve this problem only, the discrete transform has been evolved. So what is the definition what we have here? Discrete Fourier transform, DFT. So this DFT, what we are going to do is that whatever may be the continuous signal, we restrict that to a n-point sequence. What is that n-point sequence? Let us say that it's starting from 0 to n minus 1. 0, 1, 2, 3, like that. It goes to n minus 1. So we can just check it out. DFT, after transform n-point sequence, we get a n-point discrete Fourier domain signal. That is in the frequency representation. Now in the previous continuous signal, we have represented x of n is transformed to a x of omega. Now here, in discrete Fourier transform DFT, we are going to get a capital X of k. There we were getting capital X of omega. The representation also we must observe it because we should not get confused. So in discrete Fourier transform, what happens is that the, whatever we the time domain function is there, when we are converting it to a frequency domain, the representation has been changed. So it has been for finite length. So here finite length, we are considering for n number of sequence. Okay, now when we sample this continuous signal to a finite length, we are going to get a DFT there. Now as we can just see, the omega parameter, we have taken it in the range of 0 to 2 pi. Okay, so if you sample that, sample in the sense that we are taking each discrete values, whatever, we can just check it out in our particular figure there. So it is varying from 0 to 2 pi. We have sampled the continuous signal into a discrete form, okay, with equal spaced. The standard definition what we are going to get for this particular discrete Fourier transform is x of k, capital X of k, is equal to n minus 1, x of n, e raised to minus j 2 pi n k by n. So this is general and a standard definition which we have to remember it. Okay. It is similar to the evolution of the DTFT, how we have got that. N minus 1. So the reverse function in the same way as we have it in a DTFT. Here also we have a IDFT definition. There's a small x of n can be obtained from the capital X of k. That is from the frequency to the time domain. How? Which is equal to 1 by n. Summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1. Capital X of k e raised to j 2 pi n k by n. Where n is varying from 0 to n minus 1. So these are the definition of the DFT. And when we sample it for n samples, that's why the omega n is being divided by n. That is 2 pi by n. It is a n number of samples what we are going to get. That's why it is 2 pi by n. K, the discrete position values, whatever the k value what we have there. So that's the thing what we are going to get represent here. So another way of representing that omega is omega suffix n to the power of k, which is equal to e raised to minus j 2 pi by n k. The standard definition. These are the notations which we have to always practice it. Okay. Next, what we have is one of the important equations for further derivation there, lemma equation. Why we are going to derive that particular thing is that in order to get the definition of DFT there. Now we can take a simple explanation there. Summation definition, summation of n is equal to 0 to n minus 1, omega n kn is equal to n of delta k. What is the condition? It is equal to n for k is equal to 0 and otherwise it is always 0. It means that at k is equal to 0, the summation function gives the result as n. In all other cases, we are going to get 0. Proof what we are going to have. So we have is summation of n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 a raised to n. This is definition of a summation what we have, which is equal to 1 minus a raised to n by 1 minus a. Condition is what? A is not equal to 1. Why a is not equal to 1? When a is equal to 1, the denominator terms becomes zero and it becomes infinite. So this is the one condition what it has to satisfy in the summation. Now applying this particular formula to that omega n kn, what we are going to get? So it is similar to a is nothing but omega n k, which is equal to 1 minus omega n raised to k n divided by 1 minus omega n k. So, but what is that Wn? Sorry, doubles is equal to e raised to minus j 2 pi by n k. Now, e raised to minus j 2 pi by n can also be written as cos functions. Okay. So where omega n is e raised to minus j 2 pi by n. Now let us see what happens here. N and n gets cancelled. So left is e raised to minus j 2 pi by n into k. N and n get cancelled, k. So cos 2 pi k is always 1 because sine 0 or sine pi or always it is 0, where cos is 1. When cos is 1, the numerator becomes 1 minus 1, which is equal to 0. So what happens here is that this becomes zero for all other values of k there. Okay. Now same way, if it is k is zero, Wn raised to power zero, anything power to the zero is one. So summation of one, n is equal to zero to n minus one is nothing but n. So this is the thing what we are going to get from that lemma equation. This is the definition what we are derived from the lemma. This is a general derivation which we have to remember. But it's not necessary to remember the derivation. This formula, whatever we have derived this lemma equation, is helpful in solving the problems in the future there. Okay, now we'll just check it out how this particular DFT-IDFT pair is satisfying the definition there. So inverse discrete Fourier transform, what we have, small x of n is equal to IDFT flower bracket of capital X of k, which is equal to 1 by n summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 capital X of k Wn kn for 0 less than n less than or n minus 1. It means the n value is varying from 0 to n minus 1. Here n and k value will be of same length. So the above equation is known as synthesis equation. One of the important derivation what we are going to derive. In the examination, they may ask you for 4 or 5 marks. Now to prove this particular statement, let us take the RHS value. That is 1 by n summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 capital X of k Wn to the power of k small n. But we already have the definition of x of k as, here we have changed the notation to m just for our analysis purpose. So m is equal to 0 to n minus 1 x of m wn minus km. This is the definition of a DFT. Now let us substitute this particular x of k value in the above equation. What we are going to get? It is 1 by n summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1. Summation of m is equal to 0 to n minus 1 x of m wn to the power of minus kn multiplied by wn kn. Now let us interchange the position of summation. We have brought the m term outside and k term inside. So what we are going to get is summation of m raised to 0, that is m 0 to n minus 1 x of m whole bracket summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 wn to the power of k of n minus m. Why? When you take a common term, we are going to get n minus m. But from the lemma equation, as we already derived that wn k raised to n minus m is equal to n, we have one condition. What? There the condition was k should be 0. Now here it is n is equal to m. When n is equal to m, it is n. So what we are going to get is n of delta k we got there. Now here we are going to get n of delta of n minus 1, which is nothing but in signals we have seen the representation of. So in order to understand the DSP, we must know a little bit a signal processing there, which we already studied in signals and systems. The same definitions we are going to use. So it is nothing but n of delta of n minus m. This implies when you substitute that particular lemma equation in the above equation, we are going to get n of delta of n minus m. So when you take n and get cancelled, and the inside summation becomes what? M is equal to 0 to n minus 1 x of m delta of n minus m. So here what happens? Delta means what? It is a single value. What is that single value? The condition at x of m for n is equal to m. Okay, so this is equal to x of n. When n is m, we can change the rotation of m as n. We are going to get x of n, which is nothing but our LHS. This is the right hand side, which we have proved it with the help of LHS. There is a left hand side finally. So this is the definition pair what we are going to satisfy. And these two formulas we have to practice a lot. So I can just say that today you note down this particular formula. I will just send the PPT there. And I will send the link of this video also to you, such that whenever you're free, you can just go through with that one. Okay. And try to practice this particular two formulas there about the DFT transformation pair what we have there. Okay. Now, we are going to see one of the important properties, periodicity of a x of k and x of n, that is transformation and time domain both satisfies the periodicity property. What is that periodicity property? Means the sequence get repeated every n number of times there. Okay, so let us consider the n point DFT and n point IDFT are implicit periodic with period n. It means that the sequence get repeated every n duration there. Even though x of n and x of k are sequence of length n each, they can be shown to be periodic with period n. How? Let us see the proof also. Now, because of the exponential wn to the power of plus or minus kn in the definition of DFT and the IDFT, and with the help of the equation x of n and x of k, we can prove that one. How? We can see the definition of x of k. Let's take the definition of DFT. X of k is equal to n of z is equal to 0 to n minus 1 x of n wn kn. For periodic, we have k is repeated after, just add n sequence. So k is equal to k plus n. Now in the above equation, wherever the k is there, just change it with the help of k plus n. Now the LHS also becomes capital X of k plus n is equal to summation of n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 x of n wn to the power of k plus n multiplied with small n. Now expand that in the wn to the power of k into small n wn n dot n. Now we know the wn to the power of n dot n is nothing but 1. So what happens? That 1 is substituted in that above equation, which is nothing but x of k plus n is equal to summation of n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 x of n wn kn. If you observe this, x of k value is also same, x of k plus n value is also same. This shows that it is further the transformation is always periodic in nature. Now similarly, we have to prove for the inverse discrete Fourier transform also. So the IDFT definition what we have here is x of n is equal to 1 by n summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 capital X of k wn to the power of minus kn. Now same way here the LHS we have is n. So change that n is as n plus capital N because it is repeating every n samples capital N. So when you substitute that in the above equation, we are going to get the x of small x of n plus n is equal to 1 by capital N summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 capital of x of k dot wn to the power of minus k n plus capital N. Expand that again when you expand to the power of minus k n term becomes 1. So when you substitute that in the above equation, we can just take it out x of small n plus capital N is equal to 1 by n summation of k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 capital x of k dot wn to the power of minus kn. So here if you observe, we are going to get same equation as x of n. So this shows that it is periodic in nature, that is inverse discrete Fourier transform is also periodic in nature, which gets repeated every n samples time there. So this is one of the important property of a DFT there. In the examination, they may ask you to state and prove the periodicity of the DFT and IDFT. So we have to derive this particular derivation and prove it. That's why period N. So it is sufficient to compute the result for one period. Now you came to know why we are using the discrete Fourier transform. So in DTFT, it is a continuous in nature, continuous signal, and we have to transform that. And we are going to get a continuous again there omega terms, that is 0 to 2 pi there. But whereas in discrete Fourier transform, if we transform for only n samples, it is getting repeated. We are just going to add that particular summation term there. That's why it is preferable. So computer can easily perform the operation on a fixed duration of samples rather than the continuous signal. That's the advantage of the discrete Fourier transform there. So here we can see both x of n and x of k are satisfying the periodicity, and both are starting from the index 0. So for a periodic signal x of n, if we wish to find DFT of a periodic signal, we extract one period of the periodic signal and then we compute its DFT. So any signals whatever they give, we just extract only n number of samples and perform the operation, and we get the result of that particular signal there. So that's the important advantages of this discrete Fourier transform. Okay, all of you understood this? You can give the reply there. You can unmute and give the reply. Was the audio audible?
Yes, sir.
No disturbance then this time.
There was a bit of disturbance in between.
Okay. Because of some calls I was getting, so it would have been a disturbance there. But other than that, you understood the concepts today?
Yes, sir.
So if you just go, I will just send this PPT link also, PPT also to you people now. And I will send this, if it is recorded, I will just send that recorded video to you. And whenever free, you can go through with that. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay, I will take the attendance. Okay, thank you for participating today. We'll see the next class in the tomorrow session. Okay, thank you.